Podcast is part of the Pod Syndicate family. For more criminally compelling shows, articles, and conversations, head to wearepodsyndicate.com.
Hello everybody and welcome back to the Rewatch Project with Hannah and Mike. We are up to our 29th episode.
How fantastic. It's taken a while to get here.
It has, yes. Well, you've got to shoot for 29. Mm-hmm. You know, it's such a round number, isn't it?
Yes, indeed.
But yes, so we are continuing on through season two of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. We are up to episode 9 of season two. Would you like to tell us a little bit about the episode, Hannah? Namely, sure. the who's and the what's.
The episode title is Ye Who Enter Here. Synopsis says, while Coulson's team tries to find the entrance to the mysterious alien city, the rest of the agents try to rescue Reyna when they find out that Hydra is after her. Ooh. It is directed by Billy Gearhart and written by your friend of mine, Paul Zabuzewski.
You love saying Zabuzewski, don't you?
I'm almost positive I'm saying it wrong. And part of me would love to get him on the podcast just so he could say it properly.
Yeah, there's got to be an easier way of finding out what his name's. I mean, if I'm going to approach his agent for an interview, I could just ask them. let's not overcomplicate things too much. But I just want to remind people, because I forget this myself, because it has been a little while since we've recorded.
And apologies for that. We will be more regular, but unfortunately we had a technical failure, which meant we couldn't record for a few weeks.
Yes, we were using a laptop that was so old it was borderline analog. Although actually, I'll tell you what, in a world where it's considered acceptable for laptops to only last a couple of years, that one lasted us 6 years.
No, longer than that, because it was used before you had it.
Yeah, well, no, I know, but that's why I say us. So I mean, that's a pretty damn good run, and it's still working. It's just the thing with podcasts is that you need a decent processor, because when you're recording, it's recording it live. So if your computer has a little, ooh, what's going on kind of moment, that's talking but it's not being captured.
Yeah.
So what was happening was, and this might have shown a little bit actually on some episodes, was we were getting these blank spots where the before or 5 seconds was just no sound.
Yeah.
So I'd have to cut that out, but I'd also have to cut out any part of that conversation that was rendered unintelligible.
Yeah.
As a result of that. So
if there was some strange editing, that's probably what it was.
And we lost some gold, I've got to say.
Well.
But it never happened when I was going to get us drinks or, you know.
Like I picked all that stuff up.
Yeah, it was flawless. All of that stuff, flawlessly recorded urinations.
I'm nagging you about, don't tell me I can't put my drink there.
You're not the boss of me. God, and people are like, wow, and the shit they leave in.
Yeah.
The abuse that poor Mike takes.
Oh, whatever. God.
I jest, of course. I don't take it. But so what I would like to do is, now we've got that little bit of business out of the way, just want to remind you that Apple Podcasts, I don't push this enough, the best way by far of increasing your listenership of a podcast, which is always an incentive for us. You know, it's the more listeners we've got, the more feedback we get, the more, you know, it doesn't feel like we're just sort of, you know, bellowing out the window, so to speak.
Yeah.
The more likely we are to continue doing this. So if you aren't willing or able to send us feedback, then iTunes reviews are really good, because what that does is it pushes you at the rankings. And when people just do a search for film and TV podcasts, it gets you on that front page, even if it's just for a couple of days. And that's really important. So if you could go and give us 5-star reviews, even if it's just a couple of words on Apple Podcasts, if you just Google, even if you don't use Apple Podcasts to download the show, there's a regular non-app web-based version of it. So if you just Google Rewatch Project, Apple Podcasts, I think we even have a link to our Apple Podcasts page. on our main page. Just go there, and that would be really appreciated. Yeah.
Do we have any feedback?
I'm just going to work through this. Also, I just want to remind people that we are part of Pod Syndicate. That's wearepodsyndicate.com. So there's lots of content over there, audio, video, writing. So lots of other like-minded podcasters. So if you like this show, the shows that you will hear promos for in the breaks are from that network. So go and check that out as well. That's wearepodsyndicate.com. And we are also on Twitter at rewatchproj. And also... we can be emailed at rewatchprojectpodcast@gmail.com. And to answer your question, Hannah, I don't know. Let me have a look.
Nothing like being prepared.
I just forget about that. Yes, we do, actually. Yeah. I'll just go into it for you.
Cool.
There you go. So, yes, we will do a bit of feedback. And that's rewatchprojectpodcast@gmail.com.
Okay. Hey, Hannah and Mike. Ian from Derby here. Have been really enjoying your podcast, and you are great companions for my rewatch of S.H.I.E.L.D. Thank you so much.
Awesome.
It's fun hearing your takes, and you have a great balance of smart observations and irreverent piss-taking. That's exactly what we're going for.
No, it is. We'd be screwed if it wasn't. Apart from the smart bit, of course.
Was wondering if you guys could cover the Harry Potter films and Watchmen. You have mentioned both, and they are quick watches. Maybe do them between a season of S.H.I.E.L.D. If not, how do you rank the Potter films? Cheers, Ian. Thank you so much, yeah. Ian. That's Thank great. You, Ian.
Derby as well. So assuming he means Derby in the UK, then that's the West Midlands.
Woohoo. I would say a big hell yes to both of those things. The Harry Potter films and Watchmen. And I kind of like the idea of perhaps breaking up... a longer franchise with something quicker.
I suppose also you could bring in other listeners who are into those franchises
Yeah, for sure.
Maybe they'll go back and watch Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Mm, yeah, quite possibly. How would you rank the Potter films?
Do you think he means rank as in like in order or just how do
like
we...
Like best to worst, I'm assuming.
That's really tricky. I would... God, because there's a lot of them, isn't there?
Well, there's eight.
My favourite is the first.
Yeah.
Because I think that it's just...
you're a nostalgic wee thing.
Yeah, well, I just think that there's... It introduces the world, you know, and I like that. It's like origin stories for superheroes. So, God, if I was to go off the top of my head, I would say one. So from
best to worst.
From best to worst, although I like them all.
Yeah.
It's funny, actually, and I think this is where we've mentioned it before, I've often compared the Harry Potter films to the Marvel films in the way that I think that if I was to rate them, like, numerically, there wouldn't be a huge difference between my favourite and my least favourite. They all kind of exist in this one. Yeah. So it's a bit of... It's splitting hairs a little bit. But I would say from favourite to least favourite would be 1, 7A... Three, five, four, 7B, 6.
What about 2?
2 would be just before 6. So that'd be my penultimate one.
So 6, least favourite. Wow.
But again, I love it.
Yeah, yeah. You know. Okay, so for me... I am very much on the other end of the scale to Mike in that I love a conclusion. So 7B is my favourite.
Mm-hmm. You enjoy being brought to completion, don't you?
OMG, if you could see the iris rolling.
I think they can hear it, Hannah.
Okay, so 7B would be my favourite. Then...
it's tough, isn't it?
3... Then 4, then 7A, 1.
Also, 1's right in the middle.
6, 2, and 5. I don't like 5. Well, I'm the same as you. It's not
you
that
just
I don't
with
like
the, 5. You
I don't like Dolores Umbridge.
Yeah,
she's
yeah.
a very bad woman.
Yeah.
And she makes me sad, and I have listened to those books so many times. Like, on repeat for years. I've only just stopped listening to them.
Well, you gave birth to the audiobook.
I did, yeah. But I've listened to the audiobooks on repeat for about 7 years, and only in the last 2 or 3 months have stopped listening to them because I decided I needed to give my ears a break. But in all of that time, I have listened to the fifth book probably half as many times as all the others. Just because I don't like Dolores Umbridge.
Yeah, it's got that whole kind of...
She makes me sad. The story
Orwellian
is sad.
Kind of Kafka-esque thing going on.
I guess for me, like, I hate the storyline of there being division between Harry and Dumbledore, and there's sort of the comedy, well, not comedy of errors, but that misunderstanding, you know, Dumbledore is doing it from a place of caring for Harry, but Harry can't see that.
Yeah.
And we as an audience don't know that yet.
You don't need that shit when you're trying to fall asleep, do you?
No. And, yeah, basically it's just not my jam, so yeah. I don't listen to it.
Cool. Okay. All right then, well, we will...
Thanks for your feedback.
Yes, thank you, Ian. That's great. Keep them coming. So, yeah, what we'll do now is we will hit pause, we will watch the episode and have a non-spoiler review, and then if we feel moved to get into any spoiler territory, we will flag that at the end of the show. But for now, we are going to hit pause, we're going to watch the episode, and we will be right back with you.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
This podcast you're listening to, pretty good, isn't it? Only problem is, it's about halfway through. Pretty soon, it'll be over. And then what are you going to do? Well, if you're a fan of this show, why not head over to wearepodsyndicate.com and subscribe to our brand new feed, Pod Syndicate The Bonus Shows. Every week, your hosts from Beyond the Neon, Chinstroker vs. Punter, Entertainment Landfill, Film Bastards, His Film Her Movie and What's on Tap will be dropping bonus shows right onto that feed. These shows might be collaborations and crossovers, or they might be archive episodes, interviews, one-offs, and other treats from across the Pod Syndicate network. So, prepare yourself for the inevitable disappointment of this Pod Syndicate show ending by heading to wearepodsyndicate.com and clicking on The Bonus Shows.
We now return you to your regularly scheduled Pod Syndicate podcast.
So, welcome back, everybody. So, we have just finished watching episode 9 of season 2 of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., namely Ye Who Enter Here. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you said earlier on, but this originally aired in December of 2014.
So, does that mean the next one is probably just before the Christmas break?
Well, I was about to say that it's the next episode aired on the 9th of December 2014, and then there's not another episode until March 2015.
Yeah, I remember. I know what happens.
So this is the same as in season one. Do you remember that two-part of The Bridge?
Yeah.
That was at the same point, and you get these mid-season kind of mini... They're like end-of-season cliffhangers, but in the middle of a season, basically. Yeah. And it very much feels like that's what they're leading to. But without sort of showing my cards too soon, and also because I would want to have a sip of my sparkling water, what did you think of this episode, Hannah?
I really, really enjoyed it. Probably the most I've enjoyed an episode in season two.
Oh, okay, cool.
Up to this point. It was just... Like, you can see that the story is just dialing up so much, and there are... like, it's doing what S.H.I.E.L.D. does best, and what you will see in seasons to come, the way that there was like 7 or 8 or even 9 different threads all like, and they're circling around the stories throughout the episode.
Yeah.
And you can see that they're all going to converge in one at some point, but they just do such a good job at keeping them all going.
And keeping character stuff going throughout as well.
Because I think,
because some shows, it feels like they...
It's either action or character.
Yeah, they can't multitask that very well. It's as though the character stuff gets put to one side or vice versa, whereas what they do here. But yeah, I mean, I agree. It's a very high-stakes episode. I mean, I can also remember the big things that happen next episode, but there's a lot of details I can't remember as well. So just to sort of, I suppose, bring this back round to the sort of the conceit of our show, the rewatch, you know, side of it, is that I think that's one of the pleasures of it, is the fact that you go in and you're not having to Because I think a lot of the time when you watch shows, particularly very expositional, twisty, espionage-y shows like this, is so much of your viewing energy, the first time you watch it, goes into following the storyline.
Just keeping up with it.
Yeah, and also, you know, wondering where it's going to go, and also just wondering whether it's going to be good or not. Because shows do sometimes just, like Heroes, that's a great example. Sometimes shows just lose it.
Yeah.
You know, and I think when you're rewatching it, you presumably know that the show's good, or at least going to maintain your interest, cause otherwise you wouldn't be rewatching it. But also, you can kind of just drink it in a little bit more and not be... That's why the example I always use, Babylon 5, is a great one, is that it's the second watch that's always the most... I mean, I've seen that show about four or five times, but the most I enjoyed it was the second time that I watched it, because I hadn't seen it a million times, but I was able to just relax and really enjoy the performances and the storytelling. And I think that this is a really good example of that. This isn't my favourite of this season, but I think that, it ramps up things very nicely. And there's a couple of really great moments where, you know, you do feel that shit's about to get real. It's got that kind of Gandalf the night before the big battle. A lot of shows do this really well. Star Trek does this really well. The sort of the feeling almost of the, you know, the captain surveying his ship the night before kind of vibe. But no, I really like this one. Anything you want to say in general terms before we get into breaking it down?
I think there are some things we need to talk about in the spoiler section.
Yes.
Yeah, but like there just is, because there are some things that I wasn't sure if this was the point where you found out more about them or if it's in a later one.
Yeah.
They
almost came out and said something.
Yeah.
To the point where I think, and I'd be really curious to know if there's anybody listening to the show who actually fits this bill, who's maybe watching this for the first time, but I get the feeling that if you were a Marvel comic book geek, you would probably have figured something out.
100%.
At this point, that I assume, well, in fact, I pretty much know, gets explicitly stated in the next episode. I'm guessing that's one of the things that you want to talk about.
Let's get into it.
All right, okay. Well, it's funny.
My phone ran out of battery, so instead of writing my one note, we're relying on Mike's notes entirely.
Oh, God help us. But I'll tell you what, I really appreciated the previously on this one.
Because it's been, a month since we recorded?
Yeah.
So
we start off with Sky having a dream, and it's funny as well because this kind of makes it pretty explicit some of the stuff we've talked about before about the whole May and Coulson being like parents to her. Like she casts them in the role of her parents in her kind of abandonment dream.
Absolutely.
That she has at the beginning.
Yeah.
And so I think that, you know, it's been there in subtext throughout all of it. So we open up with Sky dreaming about being abandoned because she started to kind of patch together what's happened, you know, in her life.
Yeah.
With her being, you know, abandoned for whatever reason.
Quite a nice touch that she's wearing a flowery dress in the dream.
Yeah.
To kind of, you know, connect her with Raina, given that Raina is quite heavily involved in this episode.
Yeah, and also implies that she's almost like a sister in a metaphorical sense as
well. Yeah, absolutely.
You know, that she basically was the surrogate child for Skye's kind of, you know, absent father.
Yeah.
And she gets all ashy at the end of the dream as well. We see Mac
it's
having a bit of...
when you get a bit ashy.
It is, yeah, we've all been there. We see Mac falling around with a remote control Coulson Corvette. And, you know, he's starting to put two and two together
he's very astute, is Mac.
Yeah, well, he's figuring out that the Hunter and Bobby merry-go-round's about to start up again.
Well, he can see them joking and playing around, and he knows what that signifies.
Yeah.
From past experience.
Yeah, exactly. They're one of those couples that everybody, we've all known
follows
people
passion.
Like that. Yeah.
Oh my God, have we?
Yeah, they can't live with them, can't live without them types.
Yeah.
So Simmons is bandaging Trip, We get a bit of talk about Skye's dad. And basically what we are reminded through the exposition is that Hydra have the obelisk and they see it as being some kind of weapon. And they need to find a temple within the city, which is where the obelisk needs to go in order to do its thing. So the S.H.I.E.L.D. team figure that, Coulson decides that really the best course of action is just to destroy it, because whilst the obelisk is dangerous in its own right, it's not as incendiary as it is once it's combined with...
As if the temple was combined with it.
Yeah. Exactly. So he wants to destroy it. We see Rayna with sort of some kind of like sugar daddy figure. And Koenig, one of the Koenigs, picks her up. We see Agent 33 pretending to be May in kind of with her creepy face. And we get a little bit of a reminder about the Christian Ward fire. And, you know, the team are like, well, it was clearly Ward, you know.
Yeah. And I think that's just to keep that reminder to the audience that he's still a player in this. Like, he's still... Like, don't write him off. Don't forget that he has done all these shitty things.
Well, one thing, it's like one of the things that Rayna and Ward have got in common as characters, as far as their dramatic function within the show, is that they're the characters who always pop up at the end when you've forgotten about them.
Yeah.
So, oh yeah, their storyline's going as well, isn't it? Yeah. Like, Rayna does that loads of times where you're like, oh yeah, God, how does she figure into this? And again, I mean, that's a strength of the show, is that... What a lot of shows do often when they have multiple characters is that they treat the storyline separate. It's like, okay, we've done a bit of stuff with Ward, now let's do a bit of stuff with Rayna. But it's all kind of part of the same fabric, isn't it?
Connected, you know? Yeah.
So we also learn that Coulson, because they're basically, as I say, one of the big things about this episode is that they get the feeling that, you know, shit's about to get real. And Coulson's breaking people up into teams. And he basically expresses that he's worried about Skye, not just in a parental way, but just because she's so central to so many elements of this, that he feels that
sending her there would be a big mistake.
Yeah, she's got the vulnerability around her dad. You've also got the fact that she's in some way connected to this obelisk and all this
kind of
stuff.
Which they don't fully understand yet, so they don't want to put her in the path of danger, basically.
Yeah, exactly. Or in the position to actually be, you know, dangerous herself, like, you know, inadvertently. Mm. So we see Bobby asks Simmons about what's going on with her and Fitz. And basically, Simmons says that, you know, she never really thought about Fitz in that way. And that really, there's a lot of the awkwardness is just around the fact that... you know, she has ghosted him on the I love you thing. And that's just sort of left
him hanging.
Yeah. I like the... when Bobby says to Hunter, don't die out there. And he's like, hey, it's Canada. Like, what could possibly happen in Canada that's actually dangerous? I think it's nice that Skye hugs Coulson.
Yeah.
Even though they're in a very official meeting, like, she actually calls him sir afterwards.
But that just harks back to the beginning of the episode where she's dreaming about May and Coulson as mum and dad. It's May and Coulson standing there and she hugs Coulson.
Yeah.
So it's like saying goodbye to mum and dad when you go off to college.
Well, it's the irony as well that, you know, all she's ever wanted is to find her dad. And it's like, well, he was here all along, you know. I think that's the
she
sort
has
of
found
emotion.
Her dad, but it's not the dad. Yeah. It's not her biological father.
Exactly, the literal dad is disappointing in that regard.
Yeah.
I really like the fight between Skye and 33, because it's the first time that we've really seen Skye actually kind of...
put her training into practice.
Yeah, go there.
Yeah.
And it was a really... he did that thing that was very fashionable at the time. It was a post-Bourne thing. You know, the gun-grabby thing?
Oh, yeah.
Where they're fighting and they'll grab the gun and the other person will put them around and then they'll pull it out their arse or whatever, you know.
Run up a wall and break their arm as they come around the
thing. Exactly. It was very well done.
It's what you and I do on a Saturday night.
It is. We do a bit of the old gun-grabby fighty, don't we? I was also impressed with the location shooting for all the Puerto Rico stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't look like it was just them in some Californian park.
No, I believe it was actually in San Juan.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there was ancient.
I think.
Yeah, I mean, they certainly went somewhere. Mm. You know, they weren't just wandering around. Because what you sometimes get with these shows is they'll have a second unit out with like two or three people, and they'll film the back.
Doing some drone footage. Yeah,
and then it'll cut to them in front of, like, you know, a guy in a stripy top with a baguette, kind of, you know, there. But this actually felt like the lighting and the way it was shot, it looked
felt like actual location.
Yeah, it felt like location. And, yeah. And that just gave the episode a little bit of gravitas, a little bit of class. And these sort of like sweeps weeks, these sort of big middle of the seasons shows are pushing, you know, to try and increase their audience. There's always a lot of eyes on those episodes, so I think that they're like, hey, let's bust out like the posh cutlery for it, because people who maybe
really,
don't normally.
I mean, from this point forward, like, the stakes go up exponentially.
Yeah.
You know, and that's not giving anything away. That's just, you know, it does.
Yeah.
And I think all the hard work of building on all those little bits and pieces in the first half, you really come to see that in the next, you know, group of episodes.
Well, it's funny. I thought that what was happening now was actually the end of a season. And then I was like, so what happens to the rest of the season? And then I looked and I was like, oh, I thought that was season three, but it's not. It's just like the second half of season two.
Yeah.
You know, it's like they I mean, and you
season
said this before.
Season three is one of my favourite seasons.
Yeah, I mean, they don't.
If not my favourite, so. And I know how that one starts, so I know what's going to happen for it to be at that place.
Yeah. Oh, that's useful, I guess. But they don't milk it here, I guess. So I also like how enthusiastic Coulson is in Puerto Rico. Like, he's actually being a bit of a tourist and thinking, well, you know, while we're here, may as well
fried plantain or whatever it is.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. May as well enjoy it.
Let's get some tacos.
Yeah, exactly. And
after we save the world.
Yes, that's it. And so Fitz and Simmons sort of try to clear the air. They speak. And he basically says that he's going to leave the lab and work with Mac, and it's still all very wrought and, you know, emotional. Rayner says that Sky is special and can touch the obelisk as well. And basically, I'm jumping ahead a little bit here, but it's a good point to talk about it. I mean, basically what she's describing is the rapture, the idea that you've got these, that there's going to be this, you know, end time events.
People.
Yeah. And special people will survive. And she talks about how these blue angels, or the Kree, were basically going to return to Earth, and they just wanted the right people to be surviving, you know.
And this is the first time that they've mentioned the Kree by name.
Yeah. Anywhere in Marvel, actually.
Yeah. Because the Kree, when were they first shown in the movies?
Was it Guardians of the Galaxy?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, they were, like, obviously they're a huge part of the Marvel Universe.
Yeah.
And coming, like, because I remember in an earlier episode, it might have even been season one.
You see one, don't you?
Yeah, like, and I said to you, oh, it's the Kree.
Yeah.
And you said, we can't talk about it yet because S.H.I.E.L.D. is the first thing that ever features.
Yes, or chronologically.
Or anything with the Kree.
Yeah.
Like, you don't actually, like, when you're watching it in real time live, you didn't know them.
No.
You didn't know who they were.
Yeah. Unless you read the comics.
Yeah.
And even then you couldn't be sure because it might have been done differently in the show. You know, they do sometimes do that.
Yeah.
But
I quite like that something so significant was featured first on the TV
show. Well, it's like the only two instances of the TV shows feeding into the films is this and the guy who played Jarvis in Agent Carter being in Endgame as the same character.
Yeah.
That's the only time that the waters ran that way, you know?
But it's quite a significant thing for them to leave for the TV show rather than...
Oh, yeah. I mean, if Captain Marvel, the Secret Wars, the new series starring Samuel L. Jackson, that's all about the Kree as well. So, yeah, it was a bit of a coup.
Yeah, it's a big thing.
Yeah.
Which I think sort of signals quite a lot of, you know, what's the word I'm looking for? Like they had, like faith. They had faith in the show.
Of the heart.
Faith in the heart. But, you know, they obviously had faith in the show to let something like that be a big plot point.
Well, it's like, sorry, faith in the show.
I know, I could see that running through your head. She was trying so hard not to laugh.
Well, I thought it was quite sweet, because Kevin Feige recently said that, and I think that the journalist who was interviewing him misjudged it and was trying to score brownie points, because they were talking about, it was an interview for when WandaVision came out.
Yeah.
And they were like, oh, you must be glad now that you know, all the TV shows are back under Marvel Studios, and that you're finally, you know, getting to do the TV shows with a movie budget and do it right. And he's like, oh, well, I think there's a couple of million Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. fans out there who disagree with you on that. And it was as though I think they thought that they were going to score brownie points with him by talking about grabbing you. And it was nice to see him defend it, even though it hadn't been on the air for a few years and there was no business reason to do that. Yeah. He was just like kind of irritated by the fact that they were sort of like being snotty about the show, you know?
Yeah.
Another comedy beat I like is when they're trying to figure out where May is, and then Rainer tries to do a run, and the van runs, the guy's left, and the door swings open, and he's in the back, it's like, we found May! Just a nice little sort of brief character moment.
So Hunter is great for the comedy beats.
Yes. So Rainer talks about Skye's dad, and talks about how he helps people who are different. And
they're a bit petrol, as my daughter would have said a few years ago. Very
petrol. Very petrol. So she tells Skye that she is petrol. And she's like, what do you mean I'm an alien? She's like, no, you're human, but you have the potential to be more. And the obelisk, she suggests, is some kind of, is a part of that. And she says, so this is where she talks about the blue angels who fell from the sky, namely the Kree.
Yeah.
And the diviner is there. The reason they call it the diviner is it's to, in the same way that, you know, divining rods find water, it's to divine they who the worthy are.
People.
So they will inherit the earth when the blue angels return, you know, for whatever they want. So there's a bit of a, you know, Judeo-Christian thing going on there. And, you know, the unworthy will die, like the rapture. We see Mac getting on the Indiana Jones-iness by rappelling.
I'd be dead in seconds. I don't think I would be a worthy one.
Well, it depends how it's measured. I mean, it almost feels like, is it completely arbitrary? Is it just genetic? Is there some, because obviously,
I just feel like you and I would be like, yeah, cool, let's touch this thing and then just disintegrate on the spot.
With my allergies. And
and be like, no, he's allergic to too many things.
They're like, I'm just amazed he's lived this long, to be honest.
We've got no sleep apnea machines in this divine universe.
Yeah, that's it. It's like, if you require far too much assistance just to live, Mike, I don't think we're going to invest in you.
Crohn's disease? No, thank you, Hannah.
Well, yeah, it's like, you know, in like apocalypse movies, like, you know,
we don't have toilets in the divine world.
Well, it's like when the meteors are raining down and Gerard Butler's trying to save his family, and there's always some kid who needs their insulin. It's like, I'm like that, but as a grown up, you know, it's all that.
Well, you know, my catalogue of tablets on our windowsill would say that I'm right there with you.
Nah, you'd be fine. I'd just, we'd strip the sort of bark from the branches and we'd make our own medicine. You know,
we'd be feral in 3 hours.
Yeah, we're soft city folk, aren't we? So we see that Whitehall's Quinjet rocks up. Ward enters the plane, and ostensibly they're there to get Rainer, but you see and you learn by the end as well that Ward goes a little bit off grid by getting Skye to go with him, and true to his word, as it will turn out, he does let them go. He doesn't shoot the plane down, at least. Matt comes over all funny and gets all kind of like Sith-eyed after rappelling down and you know, having a bit of an episode. So 33 gives the order to shoot them, which he gets from Whitehall, and we're all set up for a mid-season cliffhanger. Before we get into spoilers, which we are going to do, it sounds like, Hannah, sum up your thoughts on this episode.
I'd give this one an 8.5 out of 10. Solid action, great character development, good mix of drama and lightheartedness. I really want to watch the next one. That's how it's made me feel.
This is the most I've wanted to do that since we started. Not, and it's not in a sort of J.J. Abrams cliffhanger bait. It's just so exciting, and I'm really enjoying it.
And like, I was so tempted to say to you, why don't we do a double tonight? Because it was just, oh God, I just know what the next episode is and it's going to be great.
Yeah, it's just really good genre, dramatic, character-driven action-adventure. Mm. And when it's doing that, firing on all thrusters, it's this good. And
it's addictive.
And I don't mean this in any kind of condescending way, because this is so hard to do, right? It's just really great mainstream entertainment. Mm.
I know what you mean. Like, it's a bit like when people think writing a children's book is easy. It's not.
Yeah.
I've worked in children's publishing. I know it's not.
Pop songs. Yeah. It's so much easier to write.
Doing a mainstream TV show that is going to appeal to the masses yet stay true to the source material.
Yeah, and have some kind of substance
drama
as well.
And substance and all that kind of stuff is incredibly difficult. Yeah. And the show is, you know, fantastic for it.
Yeah, yeah. To have that level of consistency when you're doing this many episodes, a year is crazy. And sometimes, you know, it's easier to do shoegazing stuff.
Mm.
It's easier to do, quote, prestige, character-driven stuff, because filming somebody looking out of a window plaintively, pretty fucking easy, that is,
yes.
Isn't it?
You know, they do 22, 23 episodes per season.
Yeah.
You know, all of the quote marks prestige shows, 8, 10, 12 episodes.
Well, I mean, one of the big differences is that these cable shows, every episode of the show is written before they start filming.
Mm.
They've got like maybe 5 of these fucking things written when they start filming the season. The analogy of the track in front of the train is you know,
that's very much the case.
You know,
yeah.
And to be able to do that is, it's kind of a huge act of dramatic improvisation in many ways.
Mm.
But I think that when you're a season and a half into a show and you've got a good cast, they've got a really small writing staff and director staff. It's the same names coming up again and again.
I think you need that though with this kind of show, where you need to keep a handle on who does what and where.
It is very unusual.
There's
though.
So many threads.
If you look at a lot of network shows, there's 23 episodes in a season. There's probably 18 writers.
Yeah.
That's not the case here. But, okay, well, I just want to remind those who are going to be leaving. If you could just bring up the details for the next episode, I'll bring up the... no, you can't, can you?
Well, if you get me my phone, I can...
No, it's okay, I've got it here. We will be back next week to talk about... let's have a look. Oh, the...
I know it's called What They Become.
No, it's the second highest rated episode of the second season on IMDb.
What's
which
the
is
highest rated episode?
The final episode of the season.
Right.
Sorry, I really hate the new IMDb. It does not work on the mobile app very well at all. Yes, Hannah is quite correct. What we are watching next week is episode 10. What They Become, and the blurb for this one, make sure it's nothing too spoilery. Whitehall and Coulson's forces take part in an explosive confrontation that changes everyone. Skye uncovers some truths about her past.
Dun, dun, dun.
Dun, dun, dun. Exciting, but appropriately vague, which is nice to see. So let me just bring up the details of our podcast so we can be contacted by... gentle listeners. Yes, so it would be great to hear from you at rewatchprojectpodcast@gmail.com, at rewatchproj on Twitter, and do not forget to go over and check out wearepodsyndicate.com for all of that other stuff. But if you are not spoiler averse, that is, if you have seen all 7 seasons of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., then come back for spoilers.
I'm clearance level 6. I know that Agent Coulson was killed in action. Before the battle in New York. Got the full report.
Welcome to level 7. Sorry, that corner was really dark and I couldn't help myself. I think there's a bulb out.
And we are back, so spoilers, hit me.
Okay, well, for starters, in her dream, she's listening to a song, Daisy, Daisy.
Oh, I didn't catch that.
Your answer, true.
Right, yeah.
That's what the music box is playing.
Oh, okay, yeah, so that's her name, yeah.
Yeah.
Inhumans.
yeah, we are human. Like,
yeah.
I felt like Sky was going to say, we are inhuman.
Yeah, yeah. You're astronauts or some kind of Star Trek. Yeah. But it's...
And also, like, the other spoiler thing, and we talked about this briefly, was you glossed over it in the main thing. Mac and Bobby talking about, do you want to bring Hunter in on... the thing,
yeah,
and Bobby saying no, da da da, and neither of us could remember what that was. I think it's something to do with finding Fury. Like, I think it's a S.H.I.E.L.D. versus S.H.I.E.L.D. thing. Aren't they looking for Fury's box of tricks?
Oh yes.
So I think that's what it is. Like, you, I think the whole point is that you're supposed to think that they're bad.
Yeah, but there's some...
There's some nefarious mischief thing going on, but actually, they're not.
Yeah.
They're just going to have a bit of a civil war.
And the other thing as well is that... Because all the stuff, all the big shit that happens at the end of next week's episode, you know, with Trip dying...
Well, I was going to say, Trip's going to die.
And I thought, I remember the first time we'd seen it, thinking that Mac had died. So I remember being surprised when he came back.
No, I remember Mac being possessed.
Yeah.
And I feel like he's still possessed in the next episode.
Yeah, because I remember thinking he died in the next one. Because I remember seeing somebody post on Twitter when this episode was on, like, man, this was a bad week to be black on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Because I was like, have they just killed the two African-American characters in the show?
No, I'm pretty sure that he, like, wakes up from his electrocution and he's got, like, black eyes and he just... walks towards wherever the temple is, but I could be wrong.
Yeah.
But, like, obviously he doesn't die.
So it's a big point in the show. So all the stuff in the second half of the season as well, with the whole, the Inhumans compound
Daisy,
and all that.
Daisy, you know, coming to terms with her powers, starting a relationship with the guy at the Inhuman
Complex. Because I thought, and this just shows you...
I can't even remember what his name was. This Logan.
This shows you not only how terrible my memory is, but also how quickly the pace moves of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is. I thought that Trip dying and Daisy becoming an Inhuman was the end of this season. And I thought that all that stuff with the Inhumans was the whole of season three.
No.
Because
the start of... The end of season two...
Karma Cluckin goes off and she goes AWOL, doesn't she?
Yeah, but Gemma is pulled into the parallel world.
Yes.
So, and because that is one of my favourite storylines, is her in that parallel world.
Yeah, like Robinson Crusoe so style.
Between now and the end of season two, Gemma and Fitz have to get close enough that they think that they're about to get it on.
Yeah.
Daisy has to get to grips with being an Inhuman and also overthrow her mother, who is evil. She has to start and end a relationship with a boy.
Mm-hmm.
And doesn't he die at the end of season two?
And she sort of takes on the cause, doesn't she, of being the Inhumans.
And she leaves S.H.I.E.L.D. because she feels so badly about what her thing, like her powers have had on the rest of the team.
The reason that they wanted to bring the Inhumans into the MCU, and there was going to be an Inhumans film and they cancelled it, was because the Inhumans have always existed in the Marvel canon, but they didn't have the rights to the mutants because of X-Men. X-Men, they'd sold to Fox.
Yeah.
So they wanted to bring the Inhumans in because the Inhumans were basically going to be the MCU equivalent
of X-Men.
Because they're mutants and everything but names. So they were like, okay, so all those stories about, you know, the ostracized freaks and all that stuff, we can do with Inhumans. But then around the time they were prepping to do the Inhumans movie, they bought Fox.
Mm.
So they're like, oh, we don't need that anymore. We've got the top tier ones.
Yeah.
So they're going to start introducing the X-Men into the MCU.
Yeah.
But I just thought it was interesting watching it here that I was like, oh, yeah, you can see that they were lining up the Inhumans to be the kind of the mistreated ones. And
along with all of that, there's the whole, like, still to come is everything with Ward. Like, he kidnaps Bobby at some point because Hunter saves her. They either try to kill Ward. I can't remember exactly what happens with Ward, but he, you know, he doesn't die.
Yeah.
Well, you think he's dead, but he comes back because he's the dude who doesn't die.
Well, he's like a weird monster thing, and then he's like a Matrix.
Well, he's got a different name, hasn't he? Because he's out of the parallel world.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I mean, considering how few episodes they have and how much storyline there is to go.
It's quite insane, isn't it?
Yeah.
Cool, okay, well, I'd say that's us for now. So I won't go through all of the Tale of a Tape stuff again. Suffice it to say, if you could reach out and connect us in some way, that would be great. But we will be back with you for episode 10, the mid-season.
I am really looking forward to this one.
And, let's do that sooner rather than later. Let's keep the momentum going. Now we have a working computer.
Take care, everybody.
See you later.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Podcast is part of the Pod Syndicate family. For more criminally compelling shows, articles, and conversations, head to wearepodsyndicate.com.